Good evening, everyone. I am Rachna Makhija, Senior Research Analyst with IFAS Financial India Private Limited. The topic for today is a new product launch by Axis Mutual Fund, that is Axis Floater Fund. To discuss in detail, we have here with us Mr. Shane Vass, Senior Product Manager with Axis Mutual Fund. Without much further ado, let's discuss on this product. Over to you, Shane.
Hi, Rachna. Thanks for having me. It's a kind of interesting time for us, right? I mean, in the debt markets, you're noticing that the interest rate cycle has turned, and we're at a very good situation wherein you've got a series of things that are evolving and changing, right? So I mean, you've got COVID kind of receding. Just yesterday, I was reading that in certain developed markets, you're already seeing post-COVID like phases, right? So when people have vaccinations of more than 70% as a country, they kind of transition into that post-COVID kind of environment. And that speaks volumes in terms of normalcy hitting back into the markets. And the same thing's happening in India as well. So as we see normalcy slowly and steadily coming in after the second wave, you've started noticing that the economy is recovering. You're seeing high frequency indicators kind of pointing to that, and all of this bodes well for an economy like ours, which is one of the fastest growing economies in the world. What this unfortunately means is that interest rates also will move higher. So we've been in a prolonged state of flux wherein interest rates have been at all time lows. We've had interest rates at almost 20-year lows now, if I can recollect, and this cannot go on for a very long period of time. So what our endeavor was to launch the floater fund at this point was for investors who are looking at a parking solution or looking at an investment solution to wade through a lot of this negativity in terms of rising interest rates. So that's what the floater story is from our side.
So as the name suggests, it'll invest into floating rate instruments. So yeah. How do these funds in India work? You can just explain us the structure a bit.
Sure. So there are two ways in which a portfolio manager can create a portfolio of floating rate instruments. One is that you get floater bonds. Unlike a typical fixed interest rate bond, you get a bond that is a market-linked interest coupon structure, which means to say that if say, for example, it's tied to a market-linked index, like say a three-month T-bill or a MIBOR, as and when the MIBOR or the T-bill keeps moving, the coupon also adjusts, albeit with some sort of a premium or some sort of a structure. So that's what a floating rate bond is. You also have structures which can be created artificially by virtue of derivatives. They're called synthetic floaters, which means to say that a fixed rate bond that typical mutual funds hold can easily be swapped, using an overnight index swap or an interest rate swap, which is readily available. There's a very big market for these type of securities, and a portfolio manager such as us can easily go out and buy some of these bonds and these swaps, blend them together, and kind of build you a portfolio. That's how typically a floating rate fund or a floater fund will work.
Okay, so in terms of Axis Floater Fund, what will be the duration of the fund?
We're targeting, because it's a rising interest rate scenario, obviously you would like to be at the lower end of the duration cycle because of the way the interest rate dynamics work, right? So what we are trying to do is at a portfolio level, we will try and manage a net maturity of anywhere between 6 to 18 months.
Okay, and you will be looking forward for investing into corp bonds?
Sorry, what bonds?
You'll be investing into corporate bonds?
Yeah, so it would be the entire gambit of bonds. We're kind of keeping that fairly flexible, but of course it will be a high quality structure. So it would largely be the high quality assets like AAA, sovereign bonds, some of these government bonds and the like.
Okay, sure.
So I'd like to actually talk to you about how credit also would add quite significant value here. So we've kept an enabling provision to add up to 15 to 20% in high quality credits. Now, you know, the reason for that is the current market environment. So if you were to look at the current steepness in the credit space, a typical two-year AA credit, a high quality two-year AA credit, yields as much as or on similar lines to someone to a five-year AAA bond, which means to say that by virtue of you participating in a two-year credit in this environment, you're getting the same yield without the duration. And isn't that what a floater is supposed to do, right? Basically, it's supposed to hedge that duration element. So that's why we've kept an enabling provision. And I think it will work quite well, given that the credit environment is so positive in today's markets.
Yes, definitely. So my next question is pertaining, are you planning to invest into a fixed, into some portion into fixed debt instruments? And in that case, you know, what will, which juncture you will prioritize, short, medium or long?
Yeah, today, if you were to look at the market, on a standalone basis, it's very difficult to kind of build an entire portfolio out of floating rate bonds. There will be some element that we will look to buy fixed, and then we will swap those kind of securities. So like I mentioned to you about some lower rated papers like AA papers, those would be fixed rate bonds. Or, you know, if we do get opportunities on floating, we will look at floaters as well. So fixed will be used, you know, to create some of these synthetic floater kind of structures. And we will build, the objective here is to kind of hedge that, you know, that interest rate risk that that we foresee. If you were to look actually, you know, on interest rate risks, if you were to look at the past, whenever the interest rate cycle has turned, you'll be fascinated to note that when it turns, it moves very, very rapidly. And, you know, in a matter of 15 to 18 months, some of the shorter end of these instruments tend to get repriced very, very rapidly. And it doesn't work very well in favor of investors who typically hold these type of bonds. So, picture in something like in 2008, the two-year bond or the two-year G-Sec basically moved up 350 basis points in a matter of 18 months. We saw similar situations in 2014 when the taper tantrum started, right? So if that was to happen, you know, a floater strategy that we are offering today is going to be a very, very compelling case for investors to try and navigate that very fast-paced, you know, spike that may come about in the next 12 to 18 months.
Sure. Okay. Up to 10% of your portfolio, you're planning to invest into REITs and infrastructure investment trust. So yeah, these are like relatively new underlying assets for mutual funds.
Sure.
So how do you assess opportunities in this space, and looking at their profile, you know, what gives you confidence to invest into these at this point of time?
Yeah. So while it's an enabling provision at the moment, we've been evaluating a few REITs to participate in. We selectively participated in a few over the last couple of months, and as and when opportunities do come, it will become a very, very compelling case with the government kind of changing the regulation. With regulations changing and it becoming a lot more easier for retail investors to participate. Obviously, the depth in these type of securities is going to improve quite significantly. When depth does improve, there are significant opportunities that get created. And as and when these opportunities do arise, we would like to participate in these in the interest of the investors.
Okay, sure. Yeah. So to take this conversation further, what is your view on the interest rate environment in India?
Partly, I think I answered this a little earlier, but if you were to look at where we were in December of 2020, you know, we were coming off a very, very prolonged drop in interest rates as interest rates fell. So if I recollect correctly, in about 2018, a three-year AAA would trade anywhere between 8.75 to 9%. And at the bottom of that cycle, the three-year fell almost to four and a half type levels, depending on what security you took, right? So that was almost a 400 basis point move in some of these segments. And post all of this, and post the second wave, or actually just as the second wave was kicking in and green shoots were coming back, you were seeing that RBI's stance on accommodative policies was normalizing. The RBI started something called the VRRR, which was basically a variable reverse repo function to kind of take out some of the excess liquidity that was in the system. And that gave a very clear understanding to the markets that, you know, easy liquidity is not going to be there forever. Typically, the current situation of policy rates or accommodative policies that we are seeing in the market works very well when you've got a distressed economy. And with the COVID second wave coming, entering into its final lap, we anticipate that the economy is no longer in that, you know, struggling or a tough economic situation. So it would be very, very difficult for the RBI and the government to kind of maintain these kind of policies going forward. And hence, we believe that over the next couple of months and probably over the next few quarters, you will see that the RBI will start to kind of normalize the accommodative monetary policy in an albeit gradual manner. There is a lot of pent up liquidity, so that liquidity has to get sucked out. There has to be some narrowing of the corridor, the reverse repo and the repo corridor. That will happen. And post which, we will see a gradual return to normal interest rates. Typically in India, the interest rates have hovered anywhere between 4.5% to 5% in normal market conditions. So it wouldn't be a surprise to see if the markets markets have already started pricing that in, but it wouldn't be a surprise to see that the RBI, you know, goes back to those levels in the near future, once of course normalization does happen.
Sure. Okay. So as you suggested, you'll be investing 15% to 20% below AAA instruments. So in that case, how will be the credit risk managed?
Yeah. So that's a very important question. So as a policy in this fund, we are not going to take any exposures below AA minus. So no single A's, no sub single A kind of structures. What we're going to try to build out are portfolios wherein you get a little bit of the carry, which we believe that still exists, because today if you look at the 3-year AAA and compare that with the comparable, you know, AA structure, you're getting anywhere between 100 and 125 basis in terms of carry, which is very, very attractive given the fact that, you know, the economy is doing quite well. Corporate balance sheets have improved very, very dramatically. There, on the MSME side, you've got a lot of government support to eliminate a lot of that credit risk. So for a credit investor per se, the credit risk is at a very, very favorable juncture. The recent CRISIL credit upgrade to downgrade ratio also is very, very favorable. So you've seen, you know, over the last year or so, it has moved up from almost 0.8 to about 1.33 or somewhere thereabouts. So I mean that's very, very attractive for investors at this moment. We like that space. It has been a long-standing call from our fixed income team to participate in credits, and we will take very, very selective exposure. So so that's how we like credits.
Okay, yes. And Axis is clearly marking its space. It's marking the debt space, you know, and a good risk management system is going to be very critical in this regard.
Yeah. Yes. So as a policy, we don't take duration to credit. If you look at all of our portfolios today, credit would typically, you know, hover around 6 to 18 months. The objective there is to basically try and, you know, keep the cycle of reinvestment very, very strong, so that it adds another layer of evaluations. If we like certain securities, we don't mind buying them 3-4 times, you know, over a period of 3-5 years. But what that gives us comfort is that in the event of a very negative cycle, and we've seen that in the past with a few of our competitors, that a lower duration cycle adds to, you know, significantly protecting us on the downside. And that's what worked very well for us. And we will continue to run that structure.
Yes, sure. Now we have well understood your fund. So from an investor perspective, how does one position this fund in their existing portfolios?
So, if you were to look at our marketing collateral, we've basically spoken about this as an alternative parking solution. So, by virtue of it being a 6 to 18 month portfolio duration, we would ideally like investors to at least come in with a 12 month horizon. And for investors who are looking for a very short term parking solution, not 3 years, 5 years. It can be used for longer term investments as well. But at this moment, we believe that for investors who are looking at parking solutions, it's a very good alternative to some of the current strategies that are available in the market. And by virtue of it being a true to label strategy, what we are telling investors is that the portfolio will be a floater no matter what. Right, so it will link to the entire market cycle. So when interest rates go up, the typical YTM also would tend to, keep tracking the market. When the yields go down, it will again track the markets. Right. So in a sense, what you're getting is a truly market linked floater, which in some sense is lacking in the current industry today. And it is also a great solution for those investors who are looking to, do STPs into equities, or they're planning medium term goals. All of that is ideally suited for with this fund.
So would it be correct to say so that the positioning should be between low duration and short duration?
Yeah. Ideally, yes. So that works very well. You've put it very, very rightly. That low duration is typically a 1 year product. Short term is anywhere between 1 to 3 years. So in that band, it works very well.
Okay, great. On an average, any cash levels to be maintained in the fund?
No. So the hallmark of a good floater is basically it has to time the market or move with the markets, right? So if we do hold cash, it will be a very measly amount. For the purpose of subscription and redemption, we will try to remain fully invested as much as possible, and the objective is to remain true to label. We do not want to take any sort of directional call there through cash. Whatever directional call we want to take will be through investment strategy, selection of bonds, credits, all of those.
Okay, sure. So what would be the tentative TER for your direct and the regular plans?
Typically, we will follow what the industry is going by. We are targeting a direct TER of around 25 bips or so, 25 to 30 bips. And on the regular, it may hover between 55 to 60 or maybe 65 max. But again, it is dynamic. So, I mean, don't hold me to that if it's a little higher there.
Yes, definitely. It's too early to know about the exact TER at this point of time. So, this fund should be considered at a time when the interest rates have bottomed out and the interest rates are expected to rise, as the swaps will help us to hedge against the rise in the yield. Is it correct?
Yes. So in along with the swaps, we've also got floating rate bonds. So the ideal way to put it to your clients and investors alike would be to say that you want an inflation plus type of return when you come to a debt instrument, debt mutual fund, right? So typically, market interest rates are highly correlated with what's happening with inflation. It's what's happening with policy rates. Your portfolio will basically ride out the ups and downs of the interest rate cycle as and when they come. So that is how I think you should position it at this moment. And given that we are very convinced that rates are going to rise in the near future, we've seen rates rise already. So I mean, from December to now, you've seen anywhere between 65 to 70 basis points rise in the short term yields. It's fair to say that rates are going to rise. It's good to buy some protection at this point in time, and the best way of protecting yourselves are to tie yourself to the market.
Sure.
Because floaters are basically an ideal strategy in that way.
Yes, that's a great concluding remark from your side. Any additional remarks would you like to add? with this regard?
Yeah, I mean, so I think you know, managing money in debt is very, very, you know, it's very exciting. And at Axis, we thrive on kind of being active fund managers. So it's very important that investors also stay attuned to what's happening in the markets. If they're unable to do so, products such as this, like the floater, are fantastic products to try and, you know, fill it, forget it, and shut it. From a debt allocation standpoint of view, these are very very liquid securities that we buy, you know, high quality securities. And the best part about all of these things is that because they're shorter term securities, it can also be used as your rainy day fund, right? So yes. So I mean, the floater fund as a category is built for a variety of purposes. You know, whether you are a long-term investor, whether you're a short-term investor, whether you want to play the market, you want to time the market, or you just want to, you know, get an inflation plus type return, it kind of meets a lot of those criteria when used correctly. So you know, in essence, I could term it as like an all-seasons fund. You know, that is why it is now critical that investors start looking at, you know, floaters as a category.
Yes. So, I mean, instead of taking a view on the interest rates and then deciding the category, it's better to invest into a floating rate fund.
Yes.
Okay. So thank you so much for the encouraging notes. And I think the concept and the technicalities of floating rate fund are much clearer now. On that great note, we will end our session. Thanks, Shane.
My pleasure.
We wish you very good luck for your NFO. All the best.
Thank you. Thanks for your support.
Thank you.